Probably.
No problem. Okay, so I think we're ready now. I think we have everybody, right? Yep. Okay, so, and Jim is streaming for Civic. Thank you, Jim. And we have the call-in number for public comment is on the agenda. And so what I want to do is just be mindful of the time because we have a 7:15 executive council. So we'll end this meeting a bit early. I thought we could begin with the chief and his update. And then we could go next to Jesse Lytle. And then for the third block, we could discuss the EMC job description in some detail, and the chief has provided that to us. So so I'll be the timekeeper, but please jump in if you have any questions. Okay, so let's start with the chief. Chief, would you be willing to give us an update with your two hats?
Sure, absolutely. Thank you, Robin. Good evening, everybody, and I appreciate you having me on the call, as always. I'll move through this quickly, but feel free to stop me at any time if there's any questions or concerns. I know that time is of the essence for tonight's call. So I know this is meeting number four for the year, and right now, just to give a status of the department, we still have six full-time sworn employees. Our staffing is authorized at six per elected officials. We have one chief and five officers. We will be giving a sergeant's test in June. The officers have been notified. We have followed all civil service regulations regarding that announcement. We're confident that we'll build this position for success. And the written exam will be followed by an oral exam also in the month of June. And we have contracted, as you know, with Sean Metrics Assistance, a third-party vendor to administer this according to civil service guidelines. So we're very excited about that. It's a dawn of a new day in our department, and I think that it's going to be great for morale and professional development in many, many ways. Our intention is to make sure it's designed for success, for the most part, for the good service of our taxpayers. In addition to that, I'd like to move down to non-sworn employees. Our staffing is authorized at four per elected officials. We have one parking controller currently working from home and on call for health and safety concerning the virus. That has worked out very well. Right now, as you know, considering the circumstances, we are only enforcing public safety parking enforcement concerns. That would be blocked driveways, blocked fire hydrants, too close to corner. Things like that, parked facing the wrong way, anything that's going to endanger public safety. Right now, zone and meter enforcement is temporarily suspended. However, as we start to approach mid-May in particular, I'm going to loop back with a conversation with Mayor Deutsch about recommendations on what we're going to do moving further, because we're probably going to take a step down process with that, but I've yet to talk to the mayor about that. In addition to that, I'd like to talk about our crossing guards, but there is nothing to talk about. They're pretty much on hiatus right now. Our fleet is fine. Again, I would like to loop back with personnel just to keep it at a 30,000-foot view. As you know, right now, one of our officers is not available to us long-term. I won't get into the details because that's a medical situation. And I'll leave the name out of it. In addition to that, moving down to the fleet, everything seems to be okay. Our vehicles are fully operational. We're doing well there. Nothing has changed in our municipal police officer education and training certifications. Everything is, we were doing pretty good there with first aid and CPR, but our legal updates classes have been temporarily suspended, as you know, from the virus. Moving down into our other training and certifications, everything there is pretty much the same. Unfortunately, we do have to schedule our art of de-escalation training, which was supposed to start 2 months ago, but they have not given us any new dates. And that's provided at by our work comp provider, Delaware Valley Trust Association. Moving down into the equipment, I do have some news here. We're currently, as you know, reviewing our EV and our fuel efficient options to replace vehicles. We are revisiting that project. We're hoping to get that back online because they're doing some online servicing at dealerships so we can get back on our CoStars program, which basically gives us the ability to, purchase a car, replacing the parking enforcement car, which is just a gas guzzler for no reason at all. And replace that with a more fuel efficient vehicle. So we're looking at our options and alternatives. We were before this, unfortunately, the virus hit. So I'll have, I'm hoping to have an update for everybody regarding that at our next Public Health and Safety Committee meeting, to see if we get progress. In addition to that, I'd like to move down to our deadline for Pennsylvania Uniform Crime Reporting Compliance. It usually is always we have to be in compliance for the previous year, in the current year, every year by March 31st. But this year, because of the virus, the extensions have been given to all municipalities within the Commonwealth. So we're doing very well. This week we'll be in full compliance. This is our second year in a row. And I will be sending out an email to Mayor Deutsch and elected officials letting everybody know when that has been done. Because that is an important milestone each year for any police department in the state. Visual Alert, which is our record management system, has been upgraded, as you know. It will get upgraded yet again. We just received notification that now our Visual Alert, which is through our third-party vendor, Central Square Technologies, is going to be going through an upgrade where we're going to have interfacing technology with the Pennsylvania Uniform Crime Reporting Platform, so we no longer have to enter that information manually online to a program, a database. This is going to be much faster, much more efficient. It's still going to require some oversight, but it's going to save a lot of labor-intensive hours on my part in pulling this information, because it is very time-consuming. Just as an example, each month can take, as I pull the information, review the reports, make sure all the information is entered correctly in our record management system, make sure the case status and the case disposition are accurate, as well as the case condition. And then that information is entered 1 month. If you have 12 entries that are reportable to Pennsylvania Uniform Crime Reporting, 1 month could take me up to 3 hours. So it's very time consuming. I am much looking forward to this upgrade that is being provided by Central Square Technologies, because this interface is going to be a much more streamlined process. So we're very pleased about that. We have been waiting word from Central Square. We recently got that yesterday about the upgrade. It is going to be at no cost, free of charge to the borough, and it is also going to include an upgrade to a PennDOT platform, so we can report auto accidents that involve injury or towing. Not that we have many. We only average maybe about two a year, but we still have to report them. So that's pretty much it for our status of command report. And if anybody has any questions, I'll be glad to take them.
Thank you, Chief. And this way, we'll be ready to kind of consider the EV proposal that you may explore for the parking car in time for the CIP. So I think we're on a good timeline there. So thank you. Do you want to say a brief update? We have just maybe a few minutes in your EMC role.
Sure. Absolutely. Thank you, Robin. I appreciate that. As you know, everything is pretty much status quo. The one thing that I think is very important for the committee to know is that myself and the mayor are in constant communication almost on a daily basis about the number of positive cases that come as a result of the situation report that we receive from Montgomery County Department of Public Safety daily, late in the afternoon, early evening. We have maintained a pretty steady number at 15 for quite a few weeks now. And in addition to that, we have zero deaths. That is very good news. We feel very fortunate about that. We really appreciate everybody's help and compliance with a lot of the mitigation measures that are in place. Without belaboring it, we couldn't do it without the community. We couldn't do it without the residents, the business owners, and the visitors to Narberth. Without them, we would be lost. And I can tell you right now that their cooperation has been priceless. We had one bad incident that occurred on March 20th, which was a Friday. It was soon after, within a week, that the emergency was declared. But in the end, that person was cited, not really for anything that had to do with any of the violations medically. It was for the mitigation measures. It was really about disorderly conduct. But that is the only incident that we had. In addition to that, we meet every Monday with the public safety team and the emergency management team at 9 a.m. Remotely. And we get updates every Monday from Narberth Ambulance regarding the status of what the situation is and how the horizon looks. And there are some promising words from Narberth Ambulance for the past 2 weeks. Well, 1 week, because the previous week, Matt Scanlon, their representative, was not able to join us on the call. So this past week, we got some very good information on Monday. They are looking at some rosier pictures in terms of response. I'll give you an example. Our calls for emergency medical services are down. In addition to that, even though the Pennsylvania ventilators are up for the county, it is down. So there are some really bright spots to what we're seeing, as a result of our few recent situation reports. The one thing I'd also like to mention to everybody on the call and also to the public's benefit, by all means, take advantage of our COVID-19 webpage, which is on our website, and that is updated every Tuesday with a public notice. All public notices since the start have been posted on that website for people to draw comparisons, and the new information from week to week is highlighted in yellow, so you can see those changes. In addition to that, we take advantage of the opportunity on the newsletter, the mayor and I, to give any more recent information besides that we feel that can't wait till Monday. I have been using that to my advantage to put information out there to the community. So right now, we're kind of maintaining status quo. We're doing pretty well. We've gotten a lot of cooperation from our entire public safety team, our emergency management team. We wouldn't be able to do it without each other. And the mayor has been very supportive. And the one thing I have to give credit to the mayor about, amongst many other things, is that she's always concerned about the kids, their health, and really in other ways getting back to playing. And, you know, we talk about different situations with opening the field, even though the courts might not be able to open, and her and President Muderich have had discussions. But I can tell you that the mayor is always concerned about looking what she can do locally as the mayor of our borough to really promote a good quality of life despite the situation that we're dealing with. And we really appreciate her input.
Thank you so much, John.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, John and Andrea, both of you, for keeping the community apprised with your updates and maintaining that website. And we're not out of the woods yet, but I know that you'll keep us informed, as we all try to move from red to yellow, right, and yellow to green on the governor's in the governor's plan. So thank you. I appreciate all that. Any questions or comments briefly before we move to our next segment with Jesse? Okay, so to move things along, we're going to go next to Jesse, who is here as chair of the EAC. We have a couple items that we wanted to discuss with you, Jesse, including the carbon inventory, the climate action plan, and then also looking ahead to the EV charging stations that the EAC had recommended. So, Jesse, if you would like to share anything with us in terms of carbon data or anything at all.
I will attempt to share screen here. We'll see how this goes. All right, there's that. I do that. Not sure what you... Let's see, you see my one big slide?
It looks good.
All right, that's good. My screen looks weird, but we'll go with it. So I'll cut to the chase here. So we have baseline data. Rob Schlake has been working on this with ICLEI, with the borough's support, which is great. And they've confirmed our baseline emissions data, which the baseline year is 2015. And so this is not new data, but we will attempt to update it over time. But it gives us a snapshot of where we are. and starting with the one big number. So this number, out of context, means probably nothing to you, 38,139. That is our baseline emissions data. And the unit is what you see at the bottom, metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent. Not all emissions come in carbon dioxide. They come in all sorts of different chemicals. Most of them we don't want, nitrous oxide, sulfuric oxides, ethane, methane, et cetera. But we put them in, we convert them into the metric tons of carbon dioxide so we understand their global warming capacity using the same unit. So, and this is a worldwide standard unit. So 38,139, write it down somewhere. What does that mean? Well, so for a little context, there's Narberth.
Annual number, Jesse?
Delaware Valley. When we look at our emissions per acre, we're actually really high. And that's not a surprise because Narberth is densely settled. And so you can see that is sort of consistent with other densely settled areas like the city of Philadelphia. So we would expect with as many people living in Narberth and not lots of open space, we have lots of things that are producing greenhouse gases. And if you look at it per person, you get the a different lesson, that we are actually fairly efficient because that's what urban areas do. We cram a lot of people in. And so per person, we're actually on the good side of things in terms of emissions. Now, our baseline data gives us a glimpse into where these emissions are coming from across our sectors. So in the next few slides, I'll just walk you through how it breaks down in terms of emission sources. So this first chart is not actually emissions. This is the energy use itself. And so just across our main sectors, we don't have any industry in Narberth, so it's just commercial, residential, vehicular, and then public transportation is just a tiny, tiny little sliver. And so that's where our energy is going. And energy and emissions are highly correlated, which is what I hope you take away from this slide, which looks pretty similar proportionally speaking. So this is mapping that energy use onto the resulting emissions. And you'll see there's one additional category of emissions here that you didn't see before. That's from waste and other non-energy emissions. So because it doesn't come from energy, it comes from us, our sewer water, which releases methane and things like that. It comes from our garbage that breaks down and produces greenhouse gases as well. So again, the pattern is pretty clear that Narberth is largely residential, and so residential is the biggest slice of the pie. And many of those vehicles also belong to our residents. So you see the energy around our homes and our cars and trucks is really producing our carbon footprint here. So we can dig a little deeper. This is not by sector, but by source. So you'll see still 27% of our emissions are from vehicles, but instead of looking at it from whether the emissions are coming from a business or a home, we're looking at what kind of fuel source is producing it. So electricity is another quarter, and natural gas is actually the single largest component. And of course, that's for heating and maybe a little bit for cooking and stuff like that. A little bit of fuel oil, a little bit of liquid propane, but those are really small compared to the rest of it. So what we see here is actually really helpful that we have these three major sectors that we would focus in on to try to make a difference. Now I'm going to take you in a slice deeper. So this is when we look at the sectors and the sources together. So we can see residential electricity, residential natural gas versus commercial electricity and commercial natural gas. Because we might have different strategies to get at each of these, right? Different incentive programs, different communications, who knows? But again, vehicular looms large now when you start to look specifically at these sectors, then all of a sudden you realize that the 27% associated with our vehicles is actually the single biggest chunk, and that replicates a national pattern that across the United States, transportation emissions are now the single largest greenhouse gas producing sector. And that's why things like EVs and fuel efficiency actually really matter a lot and are going to matter more and more. The way we live our lives and the way the economy is going, the way we get our food and our goods delivered to us now. So delivery vehicles factor into that, many, many factors. So that is it. That is the data.
That's fantastic, Jesse. Thank you. This is just really eye-opening for us to see some of the data.
So I sort of rushed through that because I know we're on a short timeline, but I'm happy to answer any questions, or this can just be sort of the promissory note for additional conversations in the future.
I just have a couple quick questions. Thank you for all the work that you've been doing on this, and to the other EAC members too. So the baseline data, I'm wondering, the data on our energy usage came mostly from PICO, is that?
That is a great question. Yeah, a lot of it came from PICO, and Rob Schlake would have to talk you through the deep energy sources. So he went through, he sourced this data through ICLEI's protocols, and found that it matched 100% the DVRPC's data from 2015, probably because they're pulled from exactly the same sources. But it's always nice when you go through the exercise twice and get the same answer, which we did. So if you download DVRPC's 2015 analysis of the region and emissions, you can see this data in other forms.
Okay, thank you. I'll save my other detailed questions for Rob sometime.
Yeah.
And Sean had asked that the original number you shared is annual, right, Jesse?
Correct. Yes, sorry. This is for the calendar year 2015.
Yeah, Jesse, what I'm really hopeful for from an operational perspective is to help to guide decision-making for the borough and elected officials around what could we be doing to decrease that 38,000 number, and where can we apply resources most intelligently? Does it make more sense to put our finite resources into a home composting program and buy everybody in the borough a composting bin from a CO2 perspective, or does it make more sense to swap out a couple of our cars? And I think we can just bake that thinking into all the decisions we make, and I'm looking forward to the next step. So thank you.
Great. Thanks. Those are exactly the right questions for climate action planning.
Rob, I'm just, Jesse, I'm just looking for some context, a little bit of context about data. If in 2015, the borough had a total of 38,000 metric tons of CO2 equivalent, that averages to about 9 metric tons per person. Is that on average with the rest of the population of our country?
That is a great question. I don't have the answer off the top of my head. The second map I showed you gave you the regional answer to that we're actually better than average for the DVRPC catchment basin, mm-hmm. Because we live densely here. Mm-hmm. I've seen Narberth, I've seen a couple different comparative stats, so I can't answer authoritatively. I've seen us above the national average on a bunch of measures, but that's exactly something to dig into, sort of to see, you know, you have to normalize for climate region and things like that. It's not fair to compare us to Arizona or San Diego, where it's 72 and sunny all the time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thanks so much.
Yeah, so Jesse, do you want to speak briefly to next steps? I mean, if we want to, we want to start to move from the baseline data collection stage to the climate action planning stage, what would you recommend as our kind of next steps over the next month or two?
Sure. I think ICLEI is really going to lead us through that. There's no need for us to reinvent the wheel. Right? I mean, so the constellation of issues we see here is really going to be replicated, maybe not exactly, but comparably across many, many, many communities. They're going to be thinking about how to, the questions that Sean raised, right? Should we put our dollars into things like waste stream, vehicle infrastructure, heating efficiency? You know, where is the best bang for the buck? And so there are answers to those things. They often are in a regional context because of utility prices, various incentive structures, state policy, things like that. So we're going to work through those questions. So ICLEI will tee up, I think, a lot of that baseline knowledge and some general directions. And then we would love to engage with you, this committee, and in an open community forum. I don't know how much public interest there is, but we'd love to invite the community in to help us as a sounding board on the ideas, make sure we're asking the right questions, thinking about the right opportunity sets aligned with our community's values and priorities, and then we should be able to draft this out, I hope, into the summer.
Okay, great. So in June, we could plan to move ahead with maybe a public meeting, or I can be in communication with you and we can coordinate that.
I would really value that, working with this group. Yeah.
So by the way, just out of as a curiosity, I looked up the metric tons per capita in the United States. And we average 14, almost 15 metric tons per person. Canada's the second highest with almost 15 tons, then South Korea, then Russia, then Japan is at 9 metric tons per. So we're actually a little better than the national average, it appears.
Good. All right, go Narberth.
And Jesse, are you able yet to share that slide presentation with us?
Sure. Yeah, I'd be happy to send it to you.
Thank you.
Great. Okay. So thank you, Jesse. And I guess the last thing is, while you're with us, as a committee, we have been discussing the electric charging stations. And, you know, the EAC recommended to council that we apply for vouchers through the PA, Department of Environmental Protection. And we did, in fact, secure those vouchers worth about $18,000. So we're in a position now in this committee and tonight to consider a request from NIDA to kind of round out the cost of that installation. So, I wanted to have a minute here to see if there are any questions from the committee members while Jesse's with us.
Yeah, Jesse, in the I gather that you worked on that application some with the staff. Is that correct?
Not directly. So Sean actually did all the heavy lifting. We cajoled, nudged, and offered support. But I think Sean, you were able to pull it off yourself.
And Sean, I'm just wondering if you could give us the nugget of what the primary, besides just EV stations, was there some primary goal for the grant besides offering electric charging? Supporting the municipality in charging their own electric vehicles? I'm just wondering if you could summarize that and see how that fits with the EAC's goals.
Okay, yeah. Well, the application included two sites. One would be the municipal building. The other one would be in our downtown district at 110 North Essex Avenue. In each of those sites, the budget amount was a little north of $15,000 for a total install cost of $30,560. And of course, we got the $18,000 rebates. And we need to discuss making up the gap at tonight's meeting. But what the installation of the EV station at the municipal building would do, and a part of getting the voucher is it has to be available to the public. However, during overnight hours, that EV charging station can support a conversion of our fleet over time to EV technologies, and probably their first move would be the parking controller vehicle, but we would be able to consider other fleet decisions based upon that. But that EV station at the municipal building would be open to the public and available as well when borough vehicles weren't using them.
I have a question, Sean or Jesse. I'm wondering, is there a deadline by which the PADEP grants need to be used or vouchers need to be used, and how much seems to be left in their pot in terms of how much longer they could keep offering this? It seemed like it was a large amount of money that they were offering. So do you have any sense of that? Or
it's 6 months since the award date, which I think Jesse might have been in March or February.
That's a great question. I don't remember the date it came out, but yeah, that sounds right.
And I appreciate the support, Jesse, but you guys did a lot of the work figuring it out, and Ed had a big help. And I'll tell you this, I've never seen a grant app get turned around so quickly by an approving agency. It came right back to us 2 days later with some corrections that I worked on, and then really 3 or 4 days later, we had the award. So I've never been through a grant process like that before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Pennsylvania's been pretty enthusiastic about it, and it may have something to do with it being a separate pot of money. It's from the Volkswagen settlement.
Yeah.
Which gives us confidence. I know that some state funding is being held up in other sectors, but I think this pot, what I understand, is fairly safe and as designated. That said, we've got the money now, and I wouldn't want to take too many chances with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
we're doing the same thing at the college. We applied for 10 stations and can't get them installed fast enough. We're super excited.
Good.
Yeah. So 6 months from March puts us to September or so. And given NIDA's quarterly meeting schedule with their next meeting next week, this is why I would like to suggest that we discuss this with the council later tonight to come to some decision about making the request of NIDA, since they meet next week. And their next meeting, I think, would be after our install window, of 180 days.
That's correct.
Okay, so is there support for having that conversation then later tonight from the committee? Okay, all right, thank you, and thank you, Jesse. I mean, I think the data really helps us have the clarity to say transportation is a major sector here. In fact, it's the single largest sector contributing to greenhouse gas emissions in our data set that we've collected.
Yep. Yep, and I would just add that in terms of energy transitioning, the models for automotive technology are that within 3 or 4 years, powertrain costs are going to basically swap places, such that EVs will be cheaper than combustion engines. So, a sort of an equity question. The technology is going to be more and more within reach for people, and soon it's going to be. You don't want to be on the wrong side of that, right? You want to be providing the most cost-effective infrastructure for your population. And it's the way to go for the future.
Thank you, Jesse. That, we want to be aware that most of our residents do not have driveways, and installing their own station comes at a cost. So if the community can offer this, there is an equity question there. Thank you very much, Jesse. Really appreciate your time.
Absolutely. Thank you all. I really appreciate your partnership on this for taking these issues so seriously and thoughtfully.
Okay. All right. Now we'll move next. We have about 12 minutes, I think. We need to discuss the job description that Chief Gallagher put together in partnership with Sean and others. And I believe I could share it, if that would be helpful, on the screen. So I'm going to do that.
I was able to read it over last night. It looks excellent. Thank you for your work on that.
Okay, are you able to see it now on your screen?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, I agree. I agree, Mona. So this is something that John and Sean have kind of already vetted. They started with Mona's input, but I think this is in a strong position for the committee to consider recommending to the council. I don't know if there are any specific questions that members here would like to address, or Mona, did you want to discuss the volunteer issue?
Is that something, do you think we'll have time to discuss that tonight if we have a few minutes left? I don't know, I guess the last thing maybe before we would be able to ask for applicants, right, is whether this will be a paid position or a volunteer position. I personally am leaning toward a volunteer position. I'm pretty concerned about the COVID economic crisis, and I think none of us can predict what's going to come of it. No one can predict how hard it's going to come down on municipalities or local businesses or tax revenues, because we don't know how long the duration will be, right? And how many times we'll have to, you know, they'll have to be strict stay-at-home orders. So for me personally, what's on my mind a lot these days is how can we cut as many borough costs as possible to put ourselves in a good position to deal with any potential revenue shortfalls. I like to think of ways to do that without having to cut. I mean, I don't like the idea of having to furlough or cut costs on employees. I would love to do everything we could before heading to that point. To me personally, I think adding another paid position at this point would not be a good idea. And I think that we probably have qualified people in the borough who would be willing to volunteer to do this. I think a lot of our most important positions are volunteer positions, like our assistant, you know, our fire chief, our assistant fire chief, our borough counselors. So, boards and commissions. So for me, I would recommend that we do this as a volunteer and see if we get qualified applicants based on it being a volunteer position. That's my personal opinion.
Okay. Others want to weigh in on this?
I'd actually like to hear the chief's perspective on this, given that he's been doing this job for 7-8 weeks, and whether or not it's conceivable that a qualified volunteer could have managed the task this time.
Thanks, Bob. And if I may, I appreciate the opportunity and the time. I'll try to keep it sweet. Short and sweet. The one thing that I've learned during the past, we're going into month 3 now with this pandemic, that it is time consuming, but it's not all time consuming. I do not think that this is a 40-hour-a-week job. It is certainly not a full-time position. If it was to be considered compensated, it would be, I would say, part-time or a stipend, something like that, tacked on other responsibilities of a full-time employee like myself. As of right now, some of the information that we got for our job description here, thanks to Mona, was from some of the volunteer information that she forwarded to us. And I'm certainly appreciative of that. In terms of a volunteer position, sure. Hey, listen, ultimately, I think it's the decision of council. And I am going to echo Mona's concerns about finances. You have to look at, what type of adopted budget is going to allow for operating expense of a part-time or a stipend or a full-time emergency management coordinator. When it comes to a railway passing through our community that services two train companies, SEPTA and Amtrak, and our population at 4,300, could you possibly, justify a part-time or a stipend position? Sure. Considering that, you certainly could. But the one thing I would like to say is that as I've been dealing with this ongoing pandemic as the interim EMC, it can be managed by another employee, and I'm doing it now. Now, I enjoy doing it. My certifications have from counterterrorism in Philadelphia have lapsed because it's usually a five-year merit badge situation. But I certainly remember all the finer points from doing it, and we're doing a good job as a team. The one thing I would like to point out is some of the questions that Sean and I discussed this morning during our staff call. You know, we mentioned hours. In terms of training, training really has to do with compliance, and I'll give you an example. It's usually annually, semi-annually, or quarterly. And as to further example that out, your emergency management coordinator should really conduct quarterly fire drills and evacuations at your public-owned buildings. That would be 100 Conway and 201 Sabine. We can move into that as the virus situation seems to subside. You know, just to have that documented, rally points, floor captains. You don't have to have your building packed in order to an evacuation. Those are some of the things I think that, you know, to talk about. There's online trainings that have to be directed. Tabletop exercises are usually annually or semi-annually. And when you have an interagency drill, that could be annually or biennial. So there's a lot to think about there. But overall, in terms of a paid position, I would say at most a stipend or a part-time, not a full-time position. That's simply my recommendation. Other than that, you know, I would like to defer that to elected officials. That is your decision. My recommendation right now is don't change horses mid-race. Mm-hmm. We have been doing a good job. I certainly, you know, appreciate everybody's confidence in me in trying to serve the community as best as I possibly can during this emergency. And then, believe me, I am honored to do it every minute of the day. You know, in terms of span of control and unity of command, whoever that person will be, you know, the one thing I was worried about, Sean, and as you'll see in the job description, as the virus starts to subside, Sean's responsibilities are going to be, you know, fully interactional. He is going to be interfaced with a lot of people, third-party vendors, to move a lot of projects forward. So I would leave, in terms of unity of command, that one person under that only has to answer to one person. That is my recommendation. Sean and I have discussed that, where it would be the chief of police. But as needed, as you can see in the supervision received, it would be the fire chief on a case-by-case basis if it is a fire-related emergency or a rescue-related emergency. Mm-hmm. So that would switch depending on the emergency itself, the event itself. But in terms of administration, training, maintaining resources, scheduling, coordinating, making sure that the finer points are done, discipline, performance evaluation, those things would be, you know, under a unity of command idea, would have to fall under one person. I certainly have tailored that the job description to be me. I have no reservation in doing that, and I would certainly look forward to working with that person as we move forward. But in the meantime, just to summarize, if anybody has any questions, I certainly think that we should possibly, you know, I'm not one for kicking the can down the road, Rob, but I always like to get things done. But considering the situation, the recruitment, we'd rather have that face-to-face to, you know, assess. You know, again, that's the elected official's decision. But I can certainly continue to do the job as the interim emergency manager, because one thing that Mona is mentioning is finances. And I can certainly concur with that. And that's always – budget's always a concern. If anybody has any questions, feel free to ask.
Okay. Thank you so much, John. That's all to us. And I'll just suggest now that we take this up with the council later tonight to decide how we want to move forward. Thank you, John. And we're actually out of time because I know we need to move to our executive council. So I think we'll end this session so we can move to our next one.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you all.
Can I ask a practical question? What do I do now to stay, get into the executive session?
I think we have to go into our email. It's a special email from Sean.
Okay.
And
hosting the executive session. So it's a different Zoom room.
Okay. Yeah. We have to close. I have to leave this and go into the other.
Correct.
Okay. See you over there.
Okay, see you soon.
Everybody.
Bye.
See you tonight.
Thank you, Jim.